Thank you very much. It is my pleasure to be back at Wayne Community College. And as I'm sure my introduction mentioned, I am coming to you from Auckland, New Zealand. The indigenous people here in this country are called the Maori. And as a gesture of respect, most presentations here, whether delivered by Maori people or not, are opened with a greeting in their native language, Te Reo Maori. So I thought I'd do the same since I'm coming to you from New Zealand and greet you and say, Kia ora, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā tātou katoa, whakawhetai mōtō toa. Filmgoers have used the cinema as escapist entertainment for as long as the medium has existed. Today we'll start with a broad look at all kinds of films that help us escape from our everyday lives. And then we'll focus on film genres that are particularly good at transporting us to another time and place: fantasy, science fiction, and magical realism. We'll learn a bit about how movies from these traditions have functioned during other stressful periods in our history, and we'll spend 45 minutes or so living in worlds populated with magical wizards and alien creatures. An escapist film is any film that provides a psychological escape from thoughts of everyday life by immersing the viewer in unusual or exotic situations. One question I'll explore today is it a bad thing to want to escape? Why do fantasy films seem to occupy a space alongside children's fiction, rarely taken as seriously as, say, a historical drama? Scholarly and critical literature is replete with references to fantasy films and novels as mere amusement, a cinematic anesthetic, childish distractions, cowardly escapes from real life. Well, that seems a bit harsh to me. Others have an alternate perspective. Tolkien scholar Clyde Northrup sees it differently. He thinks that through fiction, quote, we can remove ourselves from the pain, suffering, sorrow, and injustice of the ordinary world. We need this kind of escape in order that we can regroup and again face the miseries and pains of our ordinary lives. We see a similar ebb and flow reflected in the characters of the films that we love. They may escape one perilous situation with only a brief rest to tend their wounds and regroup before they must once again do battle and face monsters or miseries. We may fight our own monsters every day, but just like the heroes in our films, perhaps we need that respite, that break, in order to have the strength to fight another day. Expanding from this perspective, one could argue that escaping into these stories offers the same benefits to viewers as escaping danger does to our fictional characters. When we watch films, we identify with the characters, even if they are very different from us. We travel alongside them on their adventures, for good or for ill, and when they're startled by a bad guy or a dinosaur, when they are frustrated or scared or despondent or exultant, we experience these emotions vicariously with them. The value to be gained as a viewer from watching characters like these is twofold. One, we get the respite of escaping into a thoughtfully constructed illusion. And two, we get to vicariously escape a stressful situation alongside these characters with whom we have formed an identification. So we share in the relief they feel in their escape. And though the emotions we may feel alongside our characters, fear or relief, are generated by fiction, we feel them as if they were generated by reality. No matter how unfamiliar the characters' lives might first seem, we find points of commonality, ways to identify and connect. Their escape becomes our escape. But we don't need to see characters actually escaping from something in order to experience escape ourselves. We can benefit from any film that provides a psychological escape from our everyday thoughts, our everyday lives. But how do filmmakers get us to forget about the real world, to forget about those everyday lives? How do they get us to enter into these other times and places? What tools and techniques help make it possible for us to escape into fiction? I would argue that even with the most creative script, the most convincing actors, and expert cinematography, a film will not be as able to help us forget about the real world and immerse into a new one without incredible production design. So production design is a broad category that encompasses set design, construction, costumes, hair, makeup, props, visual effects. Some of you who've seen me lecture before may recall that this was my career in a past life, creating sets for films. So I just couldn't help but take the opportunity to show off some of the phenomenal work that this industry has built over the years. This slide shows a miniature set of Hogwarts School of Witchcraft and Wizardry from the Harry Potter series. In the early days of cinema, production design was one of the primary ways that film were able to transport viewers to another time or place. These stories may have featured historical figures, kings and knights, and characters from popular fiction. But the illusion is complete. The sets, the wigs, the costumes, each element contributes to creating the other world. And the desire to see a kind of life that we will never live, like that of a queen, was just as prevalent a century ago as it is today. Especially in the early years of cinema, when camera and sound equipment was huge, heavy, and unwieldy, it was too difficult to shoot a real location. So it really was the golden era for innovation in production design. I'm sorry my screen is covering this title. It says Black Narcissus, which is the name of this film from 1947. And this film follows the challenges faced by an order of nuns in a remote Himalayan village. It was very popular at the time, late 1940s, because it was able to give post-war audiences a glimpse of a faraway place that they had never seen before. This idea of being in the Himalayan mountains. But of course, as you can see in the photograph on the left, it wasn't shot in the Himalayan mountains. It was shot on a soundstage 20 miles outside of London using matte paintings. As technology evolved, we didn't need to build sets to scale anymore. We could combine miniature set builds with digital special effects. For example, this miniature set build, it's a New York City street scene for Godzilla, this set became this scene in the film. Looks pretty good, eh? And of course, now we have gotten to a point with digital technology that we can create a set that is entirely computer generated, like this incredible landscape from 2009's Avatar. Here is a sneak peek of the set for Avatar 2, which is currently shooting here in New Zealand. While yes, New Zealand is beautiful, it looks nothing like this. It actually does look a lot like this. This is a photo I took a few months ago on the Lord of the Rings set here in New Zealand. As Peter Jackson, director of the Lord of the Rings trilogy, knew very well, having great locations can go a long way to helping sell the illusion of a faraway or fantasy world. Sometimes you don't need a ton of digital effects to whisk your viewers off to an exotic land. Once film equipment evolved to be more mobile, directors were able to shoot on location. Maybe European destinations like Rome and Holiday or The Talented Mr. Ripley, or farther flung destinations like Darjeeling Limited's India locations, directed by Wes Anderson. I'll also argue that an escapist film could be a film set in contemporary times, nearby locations featuring fairly ordinary characters, but it's still able to transport viewers out of their lived reality and into an escape for a bit. Critics and audiences alike loved 2017's Best Picture Oscar winner, Moonlight. Not necessarily because it told the story of another time or a world, but because it told the story of Black characters that were not suffering or portrayed as slaves or servants. This film stood out because it was so different from the Black stories we so often get out of Hollywood. In no small part because it was written and directed by Black filmmaker Barry Jenkins. But because it was so different from the usual stories of Black suffering, it allowed audiences an escape, and in so doing, live in another world for a few hours. Production design might be incredible and epic, or it could be the smaller details, the props and the costumes. Maybe it capitalizes on a great location or on the technological advancements of special effects. But when it all comes together, it creates a complete world, one different from our own daily world in some way. And because of the combined efforts of countless artists and craftspeople, we are much more easily convinced. We can suspend our disbelief and escape and enter into another world. So, which genres make it easiest for us to escape? Perhaps those that transport us to other universes. So let's explore a few of these genres. We will look at science fiction, fantasy, and magical realism. I'll briefly define each of these and we'll look at some examples. Sorry again that my screen is covering it. This is a poster from Shape of Water. So let's start with science fiction. These films tend to use speculative or completely fictional but science-based elements, things that are not fully accepted by the mainstream. So if I was in Wayne Community College with you and we were in person and I was giving this lecture in the classroom, I would ask you to give me some examples and you'd shout out things like aliens or time travel or mind control, all things that are sort of speculative science, things not everyone agrees are real or that they could happen. Many monster movies like Godzilla or Frankenstein have speculative science at their foundation. If you'll remember, the monster is created by a human experiment or by an accident. These films use their futuristic or otherworldly settings to explore issues much closer to home, social or political problems, even broader philosophical questions like what does it mean to be a human? Sci-fi author Sir Arthur Clarke, who co-wrote 2001: A Space Odyssey, said, quote, "Any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic." I love that idea. Filmmakers can invent things for the movies that seem far-fetched and futuristic, even magical at the time. And this phenomenon can help us explore our anxieties around technology. So we might get used to a terrifying concept like, say, traveling off our planet into outer space once we see the idea explored in science fiction film. So Trip to the Moon in the upper left-hand corner was released in 1902, and we didn't actually make it onto the moon until many years later, 1969. In the bottom left corner is 2002's Minority Report. This film was amazingly prescient with its on-screen technology. The film is set in 2054, but already by 2021, we have many of those super futuristic magical technologies featured in the film that were supposed to be far, far away in the future. Things like touchscreens, driverless cars, voice-activated homes, all kinds of other technologies, all featured in the 2002 film, none of which was possible at the time, all of which is now part of our current cultural mainstream. Sci-fi films introduce us to the unfamiliar, like a new technology, an alien life form, within a setting or a context that's familiar. The gap. We recognize aspects of our lives and our world, and that grounds us, and it makes it easier to accept the fictional elements. So all of the familiar stuff helps get us there, and then makes it easier for us to accept the new stuff. In 2002, the personalized ads featured in Minority Report, like in this scene here, were speculative fiction. Of course, now on Facebook, they're very much everyday reality. So, once we're grounded in our familiar setting, we accept these new elements. Now we have successfully entered into this new world. Now, once we're here, sci-fi films present us with problems that we are already grappling with in our everyday life. But because those exact same problems are presented in this new world, we can wrestle with these issues at a comfortable remove. It's much easier. So, for example, the monsters popular in sci-fi movies of the 1950s often represented a fear of a nuclear holocaust, growing anxieties over the bomb. District 9, a 2006 film here, is a US, New Zealand, South Africa co-production. It's one of only a handful of science fiction films ever nominated for the Best Picture Oscar. It's an incredible film. I'm not even going to introduce it and tell you nothing about it. Just take a look at the trailer, and I'm sure you'll be very clear on what contemporary social issue the filmmakers were hoping this film would help us grapple with. Take a look.
Nobody comes back late at night anymore. They have more security.
The government noticed that they were moving into new areas. That's when things started to get out of hand.
They don't belong here.
They're spending so much money to keep them here, when they could be spending it on other things. At least they're keeping them separate from us.
A lot of bad things started to happen.
They must just go. I don't know where they go. They must just go.
We're at the breaking point. People are living in fear.
Why don't you just leave? How do your weapons work?
I just want everyone watching this right now to learn from what has happened.
This film is a great example of the way sci-fi films function. Through incredible production design, we are immersed into a world that is recognizable and familiar, but with this alien element. In this world, we can see the way refugees are being treated around the world at a remove, with enough space that we might not immediately just look away and seek escape from reality. And as we learn more and more about these refugees and the humans who police them, we get into the deeper philosophical questions of what it means to be human after all. Next up is magical realism. So this is a style of fiction where the supernatural phenomena is presented in an otherwise completely mundane setting. So one major difference I see between science fiction films and magical realism is that sci-fi at least attempts to explain the otherworldly. So, for example, Godzilla is a so he's supposed to be a prehistoric creature awakened by atomic bomb testing in the ocean. Okay, it's a reason. Magical realism doesn't even try to give you an explanation. Maybe the characters within the fiction wonder how it could be, but we don't dwell on the hows or the whys. Mexican-American author Luis Leal explains it perfectly in this quote along the bottom. If you can explain it, it's not magical realism. So let's take a look at a scene to help wrap our heads around this idea. This is from 2005's Chronicles of Narnia, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. Most of us will know this story. And let's see how our young heroine Lucy reacts when her mundane world bumps up against a magical one. I love all the mundane details in that scene. The fly trapped inside the window or the mothballs coming out of the wardrobe. For me, they help ground the scene, make it feel real. So I'm ready to go with Lucy when she discovers something unreal, something unexplainable. Narnia inside the wardrobe. Again, once we are safely ensconced in this world, going along for the ride is easier, and we can wrestle with tougher topics later in the film, like sacrifice and betrayal and forgiveness, all at a comfortable remove. Hopefully, now you're still coming along for the ride, ready to go with me one step further into the land of fantasy. So these are films that may have no recognizable elements from our world. Different creatures, planets, histories, cultures all populate fantasy. And so the production design really must sell this idea of a completely new place. Fantasy novels and films, of which the Lord of the Rings series are exemplars, tend to feature clear villains and heroes who are obviously good or evil. For example, is Sauron, the villain of the Lord of the Rings, wearing that all-powerful ring on his finger. He has no backstory that might help us understand why he's so evil. It's not like he fell on hard times, something, victim of a tragedy that turned him rotten. Now, he's not complex. He's not a flawed anti-hero who's done some good and some bad. He's just a massive, evil creature with a helmet made out of blades who wants to take over the world. You're not supposed to identify with him or root for him. It's not hard to know which side we're supposed to be on. All of this bears very little resemblance to the real world. In the real world, evil is usually a bit more subtle. People are a bit more complicated and changeable. Fantasy films give us a break from trying to figure out if someone's good or evil. We know who the heroes are. And here he is, Frodo. He is a small hobbit tasked with a seemingly insurmountable mission of trekking across kingdoms into the most dangerous place in his world. He's got to destroy that magical ring we've just seen before that evil being we've just seen can find it and take over the world. So on the surface, the plot is not relatable. We don't have to destroy magic rings here in our world. How can we identify with any of what's going on in this story? What fantasy films lack in familiar foundation, they more than make up for in aspects of the human condition. Sure, maybe the details of Frodo's world aren't familiar to us, but the core elements of Frodo's situation absolutely are. Fear in the face of pain or death. Uncertainty. Feeling too small or insignificant to possibly make a difference. To possibly be able to defeat a foe much more powerful than you are. Feeling so overwhelmed with the enormity of a challenge in front of you that you feel paralyzed about how to even start. Wishing someone else had this job instead of you. Sam is Frodo's best friend and joins him on the quest. Again, aspects of Sam's situation upon reflection are remarkably identifiable. Sam shows us the bravery exhibited by some, and by contrast, the panic, denial, and inaction shown by others. Sam reminds us that we are stronger together, that even the smallest and seemingly least important of us can wield incredible power. That sometimes just showing up, just being there for someone is exactly what that person needs. So let's take this notion of the emotional core of these characters and their situations. Let's take that with us into a viewing of this scene from the second film in the Lord of the Rings trilogy, The Two Towers. All you need to know about this scene is that we have a king who feels abandoned by his allies. He's under attack by an army of monsters, and there are a few warriors there to help him, but he feels overwhelmed by what faces him.
The fortress is taken.
It is over.
You said this fortress would never fall while your men defend it. They still defend it. They have died defending it.
I'm breaking in!
Is there no other way for the women and children to get out of the caves? Is there no other way?
There is one passage. It leads into the mountains. But they will not get far. The Uruk-hai are too many.
Send word for the women and children to make for the mountain pass and barricade the entrance.
So much death. What can men do against such reckless hate?
Ride out with me. Ride out and meet them.
For death and glory.
For Rohan. for your people. The sun is rising.
Look to my coming at first light on the fifth day. At dawn, look to the east.
Yes. Yes.
The horn of Helm Hammerhand shall sound in the deep. One last time. Yes!
This be the hour when we draw swords together.
Fell deeds awake.
Now for wrath, now for ruin, and the red dawn.
We've got this incredible sequence full of fantasy elements, wizards and monsters, and some knights in shining armor. Everything our critics suggest would be perfect fodder for our amusement, our distractions from our everyday world. But we also have this pivotal line delivered by King Theoden. He says, "So much hate. What can men do against such reckless hate?" Oh, no, he says, "So much death. What can men do against such reckless hate?" In the wake of a school shooting or a church bombing, an attack on a mosque or a gay nightclub, we might feel this sentiment. We may very well want an escape from such a reality. We might very well wonder what we can possibly do against such reckless hate. Here in the film, Aragorn answers, "Ride out with me." He wants the king to fight against that hate no matter the odds, not for fame or for glory, but for the people around him who need him to fight for them. Since the dawn of cinema, humanity has weathered plenty of crises, world wars, recessions, depressions, civil unrest, riots, pandemics, the works. And people often wonder several things about the film industry during these times. does the industry flourish during stressful periods because people really want escape? They go to the movies more often. Does the subject matter noticeably change during these times to reflect the tough times folks are living in or to help provide that escapist fiction? Let's take a look. We'll start with the Great Depression. This began with the Wall Street crash of 1929 and continued for roughly a decade. So we're going to look at the top grossing, most popular films from 31 to 1935, just to get a snapshot picture of what Americans were interested in watching in those first few years of the Great Depression. Were they looking for escape into films of a much different time and place? Were they even still going to the movies when money was so scarce? Let's take a look. The truth is, in 1930, American cinema attendance dropped by 56%. As a result of that trend, a number of studios were forced into bankruptcy, and more than one-third of the cinemas in America closed between 1929 and 1934. Historian Richard Butch notes that the Great Depression, quote, halted the promotion of moviegoing as an experience of luxury at the movie palace. In its place, price, comfort, and distraction from worries became the selling point. So moviegoing kind of went back to its roots as being a place where working class people could find entertainment with their very precious leisure time. And at an average price about 27 cents a ticket, movies offered a relatively inexpensive way to get a vacation from reality. So, what did everybody watch? Several of the most popular, well-attended films of the early 1930s were those directed by Busby Berkeley. He was known for elaborate dance numbers, huge expensive sets, and pioneering an overhead camera angle that resulted in a kaleidoscope-like effect, dancers and set pieces moving in synchrony. His popularity with an entertainment-hungry Depression audience was evident. He choreographed five musicals back-to-back in less than 3 years, all of which were huge hits. This is the lobby card for the human waterfall he designed for 1933's Footlight Parade. Let's take a look at this incredible feat of engineering, cinematography, choreography, and athleticism.
We'll be right back.
Another huge star of the early 1930s was Mae West. In both of these films from 1933, West plays a bawdy, burlesque singer and dancer who interacts with plenty of unsavory characters and pickpockets. She was a veteran of vaudeville and Broadway and usually wrote her own risque one-liners full of sexual innuendo. During the difficult times of the Great Depression, many filmgoers responded to West. They loved her portrayal of a woman from the wrong side of the tracks, achieving success, the darling bad girl who climbed the ladder of success wrong by wrong. Her pictures function similarly to gangster films, which were also enormously popular in the years right after the crash. Historians suggest that Depression-era audiences felt let down by society, and so they cheered on these characters who defied the establishment, refused to play by the rules, and just took what they wanted. We also saw plenty of historical period pieces featuring exotic locations. Two of the top three films of 1935 were about ocean voyages. And the last big trend we'll discuss related to the Great Depression is the rise of a new subgenre of film called the screwball comedy. So, in screwball comedies, we usually get a confident, fast-talking heroine, and audiences are able to explore class issues, differences between classes in a funny and non-threatening package. So in these films, the upper class are represented as idle, pampered, and spoiled. They cannot survive in the real world. They can't do anything by themselves. And by contrast, the lower class characters pass themselves off as upper class with relative ease. They're quick-witted, resourceful, and smart. And often we get a love match across class lines. And it's the working class character who has to bail out the high society person out of countless catastrophes. So imagine Depression era audiences. Imagine their glee at watching the rich upper class taught a lesson in humanity by a member of the working class. Audiences got it both ways. They got to see the sumptuous life of the rich and then watch them struggle, all wrapped up in a shiny bow of opposites attract romance. Of course, probably the escapiest of all escapist films of the 1930s is The Wizard of Oz from 1939, where our heroine dreams of a place far away where troubles melt like lemon drops. So we had the pre-code gangster movies, the Mae West vehicles that allowed audiences to cheer for the bad characters who break society's rules, the glittery song and dance musicals by Busby Berkeley or Rodgers and Astaire that allowed audiences to step into a world of glamour, or the screwball comedies that did a little bit of both, show off the high society world, but also teach those upper crust characters some lessons. Whatever your flavor, most of the films directly or obliquely reflected the Depression. Characters talked about it, plots were centered around it, they didn't ignore it or pretend it wasn't there. They just invented ways to work through the issues Americans were dealing with around the Great Depression. Let's talk about another era, more recent, and another troubling time in our history. I did not live through the Great Depression, but I did live in New York City as a student at NYU on September 11th, 2001. So I can personally confirm that at least in New York, in the wake of tragedy, going to the movies was at the top of our to-do list. The top three grossing films that year were all fantasy or magical realism: Harry Potter, The Lord of the Rings, and Monsters, Inc. Now, remember, these films were all shot, edited, fully completed by September 11th. They were just waiting for their release date in theaters. So we're not arguing that studios were responding to a nation in mourning and creating a lot of fantasy films to help fill in the gaps. Definitely not. But man, oh man, we were so glad that the timing worked out. All three of these films were released after September 11th, October, November, and December. And even being at the tail end of the calendar year, they still managed to make enough money to be the top three earners of the year. So clearly, post 9/11, Americans were into going to the movies. And unlike the Depression era, Hollywood avoided explicitly referencing the attack of September 11th for 5 years. It took 5 years before a studio even attempted to retell the story head on, and most of the films were completely panned. Instead, our big hits in the years that followed were exactly what you'd expect. Heavy on the fantasy and science fiction, heaps of wizards and aliens, and even a few pirates thrown in for good measure. So whether it's wizards or witches, gangsters or showgirls, hobbits or fauns, whether you prefer a historical epic or a futuristic adventure, whether it's in a completely alternate universe or a song and dance number right here at home, I hope you take some time to escape from reality for a few hours into a world of glamour or mystery or fantastic creatures. It'll do you good to check out of the real world for a bit, and you may come to a better understanding of some of the very issues that you are trying to escape. From all of us here in the land of the hobbits, thank you so much for your kind attention. Kia ora.